Welcome students to today's lecture on endodontic emergencies. The learning outcomes for this lecture is to describe endodontic emergency, recognize what constitutes a true emergency as opposed to urgency, identify the causes of emergencies that occur before treatment, during treatment, and after obturation, describe management of endodontic emergencies. It has been seen that more than 90% of the patients who come to dental treatment with severe pain usually have symptoms of palpal and periapical diseases. So as a clinician, it is very important for you to have adequate knowledge and skill in various aspects of endodontics to successfully treat these endodontic emergencies. What is an endodontic emergency? Endodontic emergency is defined as a condition associated with pain and or swelling which requires immediate diagnosis and treatment. There are certain times in your clinical practice when patient may report to your clinic with very severe unbearable pain which might be due to palpal or periapical infection. These conditions may require your immediate attention, and such conditions are called as endodontic emergency. Before the management of endodontic emergencies, one should be able to differentiate through diagnosis and history taking between a true emergency and an urgency. A true emergency is a condition, as I said, which requires an unscheduled visit with diagnosis and treatment at the same time. An urgency indicates a less severe problem, which may be scheduled to next visit for mutual convenience of both patient and dentist. So there are three key questions which we'll be asking the patient, okay, to determine if it is an endodontic emergency or urgency. The first question is, does this problem disturb your day-to-day or daily activities, which can be sleeping, eating, working, concentrating on your daily activities? If a patient says that, doctor, I cannot concentrate on anything, this pain is so severe that I cannot sleep, I cannot eat, I cannot concentrate on my work, then it can be said as endodontic emergency. The second question we are asking the patient is that, this, how long this pain has been bothering you? A true emergency rarely been severe more than few hours or maybe 2 days. Okay, if it is longer than that, then we consider that one is a chronic problem. We can put that one into an emergency condition. Then the third question we'll be asking is that, are you taking any medication or painkillers or analgesics? After taking this medication, is the pain relieved? If the answer from the patient is that, yes doctor, I am taking these medications but it is of no use, or else this medication works for 1 or 2 hours and again the pain comes severely. So if during your history taking these three questions are positive, then it can be confirmed that it is an endodontic emergency and immediate treatment is required for the relief of pain. So what do you do when a patient reports to your dental clinic with severe pain due to palpal or periapical infections and requires your immediate attention? First and foremost is an accurate diagnosis required, which includes complete and precise history taking along with clinical examination. These are the most important two basic steps which is required for successful management of endodontic emergency. History taking should be able to establish two components. One is time, the second one is severity. You should include questions like, where is the pain? When was the pain first noticed? Can you describe pain? What type of pain is it? Like, is it throbbing pain? Is it dull pain? Is it severe pain? Is it lacerating type of pain? You should encourage the patient to describe the pain. Under what circumstances does the pain occur? Which means that, does the pain occur when you take cold, or the pain occurs when you're eating, or when you take coffee, or it starts by its own self? Okay, these are the things. What do you mean by under what circumstances does the pain occur? Does anything relieve pain? Ask about the relief. मेक ए नोट ऑफ एनी एसोसिएटेड टेंडरनेस और स्वेलिंग, टेक ए डिटेल हिस्ट्री ऑफ पास्ट डेंटल ट्रीटमेंट्स, पेरिडोंटल ट्रीटमेंट्स, एनी हिस्ट्री ऑफ ट्रॉमा टू द टूथ, मेक ए पर्टिकुलर नोट ऑफ एनी अदर कंडीशंस विच मे मिमिक लाइक पेन ड्यू टू पल्पल और पेरियापाइकल इन्फेक्शंस, एग्जाम्पल मायोफेशियल पेन डिसफंक्शन सिंड्रोम, न्यूरोलॉजिकल डिसऑर्डर्स लाइक ट्राइजमिनल न्यूरलजिया, वैस्कुलर पेन सिंड्रोम्स, मैक्सिलरी साइनस डिसऑर्डर्स. यू वांट टू रूल आउट दिस कंडीशंस इन बिफोर यू मेक ए टेंटेटिव डायग्नोसिस. After the history taking, the second step is thorough clinical examination. In this, various objective tests are carried out, and if required, radiographic examinations, as well as other tests such as pulp sensibility tests like thermal tests and electric pulp tests are carried out. A decision has been made that it is an endodontic emergency and immediate treatment is required. That starts the treatment planning. So before the dentist starts his treatment, it is necessary that he follows two basic preparatory steps. One is patient management or reassurance. You need to give reassurance to the patient that the pain will be relieved, he'll be okay by the end of the treatment. The second one is the profound anesthesia of the inflamed tissues. So after these basic preparatory steps comes the definitive treatment, which includes reduction in tissue pressure of the pulp and periradicular tissues and or resection of the inflamed tissues, and to eliminate allodynia and patients who present as endodontic emergencies can be categorized into three main groups: pre-treatment emergencies, intra-treatment emergencies, and post-endodontic emergencies. The conditions included in pre-treatment emergencies are symptomatic reversible pulpitis, symptomatic irreversible pulpitis, acute alveolar abscess, acute periodontal abscess, traumatic fractures like crown fracture, root fracture, and tooth avulsion. Under endodontic emergency is symptomatic reversible pulpitis. Symptomatic reversible pulpitis is a mild to moderate inflammatory condition of the pulp caused by noxious stimuli in which the pulp is capable of returning to the uninflamed state following the removal of stimuli. The causes can be caries, disturbed occlusion, thermal shock due to heat or cold, chemical stimuli, trauma, marginal leakage within a restoration, or a high restoration. So you have to remember that some patients with a lower threshold can also perceive an symptomatic reversible pulpitis as an endodontic emergency. Features of reversible symptomatic pulpitis is localized inflammation of the pulp, exaggerated pain response to stimuli, which is non-lingering in nature. That means whenever there is a stimuli is there, the pain will reduce within somewhere around 5 to 10 seconds. If it is reduces between 5 to 10 seconds, you can categorize it as reversible pulpitis. If it is more than 5 to 10 seconds, you have to categorize as irreversible pulpitis. The management of reversible pulpitis is removal of the stimuli, recontouring of the restoration, relieving hyperocclusion, and use of sedative dressing if the pain persists. Second condition is symptomatic irreversible pulpitis. It is defined as persistent inflammatory condition of the pulp caused by noxious stimuli. Causes: caries is most common cause. Second is the same causes from reversible pulpitis. Symptoms: pain that lasts for minutes to hours, which is sharp and lacerating following exposure to cold or hot foodstuffs. The pain persists even after the removal of stimuli. So this is the difference between a reversible and irreversible pulpitis. In reversible pulpitis, once you remove the stimuli, the pain immediately reduces. Whereas in irreversible pulpitis, the pain persists for a longer time, from few seconds to minutes to hours also. Patient may also complain that bending over or lying down exacerbates the pain. Treatment for you is usually pulpectomy. You anesthetize affected tooth, isolate with rubber dam and prepare an access cavity, remove the pulp from the chamber, irrigate and debride the pulp chamber. The preferred irrigant is usually sodium hypochlorite. Dry the root canal with sterile absorber points. Insert a medicated cotton or then place a temporary restoration such as zinc oxide eugenol. Relieve any occlusal trauma and prescribe an analgesic and call for next appointment. Next condition is acute alveolar abscess. This is a very, very painful condition. It is defined as a localized collection of pus in alveolar bone at root apex of the tooth following the death of the pulp. Causes can be pulpitis affecting the periapical tissues, exacerbation of the chronic periapical lesions, or from periodontal abscess, which secondarily affects the pulp. Symptoms are usually systemic, which includes fever, malaise, GI disturbances, and lack of sleep. Local symptoms are severe pain and swelling. Swelling is a must. So in this picture, you can see an intraoral acute alveolar abscess. Most important aspects in treatment of acute alveolar abscess is to establish the drainage. Establishing the drainage immediately reduces the pain by reducing the tissue pressure inside. You can achieve drainage through the root canal or through the soft tissues, or else establish drainage both through the root canal and the soft tissue, which is the most effective mechanism. So how do you establish drainage through the tooth? First, after adequate anesthesia, usually a block anesthesia, because a local anesthesia is not effective, isolate the tooth, complete the access opening painlessly by bracing the tooth with finger pressure, irrigate and debride the pulp chamber with sodium hypochlorite, locate the canals and explore the canals using very thin files such as 8 to 10 size files. Purulent exudate usually may come out, which indicates drainage, and relief of pain follows very quickly. You can prescribe analgesics. Antibiotics is only indicated if there are systemic symptoms of fever and malaise. Okay. So in this picture, you can see that the purulent exudate is coming through the access cavity of the central incisor. If the soft tissue swelling is present and pointing intraorally, then you can use a BP plate, maybe a 15 size BP plate, to incise and establish drainage as well. The presence of cellulitis may result in little or no drainage. If there is extensive cellulitis, medical advice is required. Okay, don't refer to a hospital setting or to a general surgeon or a oral surgeon. So here you can see a picture of a teenage patient who has a large periapical lesion in the lower incisor region developing cellulitis. So how do you establish a drainage of an intraoral alveolar abscess? Incision to establish drainage is the only surgical endodontic procedure which may be undertaken when acute inflammation is present. The soft tissue swelling should be examined to see if it is fluctuant. Where the swelling is pointing intraorally, copious amounts of surface analgesia should be applied, for example, ethyl chloride or topical lignocaine ointment. Regional anesthesia may not be effective due to presence of pus, and administration of local LA solution may spread the infection further into the tissues. Avoid infiltrations in these situations. Incise the swelling with a BP blade number 11 or number 15 scalpel blade, or aspirate using a wide bore needle and disposable syringe. It may be possible to aspirate the abscess via root canal as well. The advantage of this technique is that sample can be sent for bacteriological examination if required. It is not usually necessary to insert a drain, but if it is thought necessary, then a piece of 1/4 inch or 1/2 inch salvage gauze may be used. In this slide, you can see a picture of patient with extraoral swelling. Extraoral swelling, usually if it is there and requires an incision and drainage, it is better we refer the patient to an oral surgeon or a general surgeon, and better treated in a hospital setting. So refer this kind of patient with extraoral swelling to a general or oral surgeons. Analgesics should be sufficient for most of the cases with acute alveolar abscess, but if you doubt that there is a systemic spread of infection and the patient is unwell and has raised temperature, then you can give antibiotics. Antibiotics are not an alternative to appropriate cleaning and disinfection of the canal. There is a serious tendency to overprescribe antibiotics in situations where they are not indicated. If, however, you feel that antibiotics is required, then most commonly you can prescribe amoxicillin 250 mg 3 times daily or 500 mg 3 times daily until the infection is under control and root canal therapy is initiated. An alternative to amoxicillin is metronidazole, where penicillins are contraindicated. Coming to the next condition, which is acute periodontal abscess. Acute periodontal abscess is a painful inflammation of the periodontium as a result of trauma, irritation, or infection through root canal, regardless of whether pulp is vital or non-vital. The causes of acute periodontal abscess in a vital tooth are occlusal trauma due to abnormal occlusion, high restoration, wedging a foreign object between the tooth, and trauma to the tooth. So this is a picture of the acute periodontal abscess. Okay, if you see here, it is a root canal treated tooth. There's an infection which is spreading to the periodontium from lateral canals, okay, in a failed root canal treatment, leading to acute periodontal abscess. Acute periodontal abscess in a non-vital tooth can be a sequelae to pulpal diseases. It can be due to iatrogenic causes during root canal treatment, such as instrumentation beyond root apex, forcing the bacteria or debris into the periodontal space, forcing of irritant medications into the periapical region or into the periodontal. Symptoms: pain, which can be very severe, tenderness over the tooth. Tooth may be extruded, making closure painful. Treatment: if the tooth is vital, emergency treatment usually includes a curettage, debridement, and establishing drainage of infrabony pocket through sulcular crevice. If the pulp is affected and the tooth is non-vital, then the tooth should be treated as that of acute irreversible pulpitis. If the tooth is necrotic, then treat that like acute alveolar. I will cover the next part of intra-treatment emergencies and post-endodontic emergencies in my next lecture. Thank you.